Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. You know, I really appreciate this chance to speak to you because I get to research the most interesting things to talk to you about. And if I had spent all the time doing it for myself, I wouldn't. You know, just to do it for myself is not enough, but to be able to do it for you, that's inspiring. And to read through so much material and give you a kind of a digest of it, I really appreciate that when somebody does it for me, so I'm happy to do that for you. But just the same, there's always a caveat I need to put in here. I'm not asking you to believe anything. Belief is not really the approach I like to take. Belief is about emotions. People that believe things really strongly like to fight about them too. And beliefs tend to be black or white, you know. I believe it or I don't believe it, you know. That's emotional. Emotional level is usually pretty dramatically polarized. But if we get into the mental level, there are shades of gray, and it's there where we can really use our common sense. And Lawrence, he praises common sense continually. But what he means by it is, we've had our experiences of life, we've digested them, and we know darn well what's true and what's not through our own common sense. That's what, you know, when we can say, well, you know, if that happens, I think that person will probably do that, and we're going to be right because we've been there, we've done it ourselves, we've seen it before. That kind of common sense, it's one of the good things about Buddhism, actually. I mean, I think it was Buddha that said, never accept anything that disagrees with your common sense. So, if questions arise, if something seems to disagree with your common sense, I want you to go ahead and ask questions. I'll be happy to answer them. And in fact, at the end of the talk at 5:30, the talk is officially over, but I will stay on for half an hour or so just answering questions and be happy to help with anything I can. And if you ask a question during the talk, I may defer you to later because I'll be covering some things later or maybe to the end of the talk, but I do still want to hear what's going on in your minds about all this. I know a lot of you have been to a number of my talks. This is my seventh talk here. And some of what I'm doing here will be summarizing. There's an exercise that I really like to start these talks with. And I'm going to cut right to the whole punchline of the whole plan idea. What Lawrence, he says, is that everything, and this is what Hylozoic says, Lawrence, he says, this is what Pythagoras taught long, long ago, is that there is matter, motion, and consciousness. That's it. Everything is derived from that, made out of it, and these are the three a priori things you just have to start with and accept, because you can't deduce them out of anything else. He says that we are, each of us, these three things. But the most important really is consciousness. And that the purpose of life, he says, is the evolution of consciousness. So let's take a moment and be aware of our consciousness. And try to be really self-conscious, and not like a self-conscious teenager, but be aware of where our consciousness is originating. Where our attention is where the self is. So if we just take a moment and ask, who is watching? Who is paying attention? Who is listening? Where is this attention coming from? You turn the attention back around to look within and see where that attention originates. That's being conscious of the self. I think it's a great exercise. Most of the difficulty that we have in life is due to the things that happen through our lack of being conscious. You know, we have mechanical patterns and emotional patterns and things that suddenly we find ourselves angry, or suddenly we've done something, said something mean to a person we love, and that sort of thing is built out of emotional patterns that you only, well, Lawrence, he calls them mechanical thinking. They happen because they always happen, right? They just have their own innate tendency to happen. But to the degree that you are conscious of your consciousness, you are not subject to mechanical thinking. You can be free from all those things by simply being aware and choosing every instant of where your attention goes. So My name is Stanton, as you know, and throughout my life, I have had the question asked of me, "What's the plan, Stan?" So now I get to try to answer that question. There are a lot of possible answers to that. Let's go through some of the answers that religion and other things give. Certainly one idea is that the plan is God's will. And I gave a talk about God's will already, and the title of the talk was, God's will is, you choose. So that's not a very specific plan. But of course, the plan is that we are able to choose. And that points out something really important about the divine beings. They're not actually dictating to us that we have to do this and that to be good in their eyes and lots of worship and that sort of thing. They're absolutely in acting in respect of, you know, respecting the laws of the universe. And one of them is the law of freedom that says that you don't have any right to impose any your will on anybody. You do have the right to do whatever you choose to do as you're in your progress and trying to learn, as long as it doesn't impinge on the equal right of others. And that's how we create an awful lot of karma in this world, is by interfering with other people's right to do and say what they want to do. People who follow the path of power specifically get in trouble with that. So God's will, you know, there are some good things in that too, the idea of God's will, but I'm going to get to that later when we talk about everything that's above and beyond human. Another approach to reality that addresses ideas like the plan is science. And it wasn't until Darwin came along that it was even accepted that things change. The idea of evolution started with just accepting that things change. Once that was accepted, that brought up quite a big topic. You know, where are they going if they're changing? And Darwin's answer was very much based on physical. That all these physical forms are competing with each other, and it's survival of the fittest, and it's the opportunity to pass your genes along and reproduce successfully. Well, that's, you know, that doesn't really offer very much as far as a goal for any of us. If that's the goal, then we're at the service of our genes and our bodies, is what that's saying in a way, trying to perpetuate our bodies. Is that really what we're here to do? There are two big factors that are left out of the scientific view entirely, not just the view of evolution. And one of them is consciousness that we just dealt with. In a lot of psychological views and medical neuroscience and things like that, consciousness is looked at as a byproduct of our body's energy field, you know, our electrical impulses, and consciousness is a byproduct that helps us evolutionarily because maybe you're more aware of how to get things done and acquire food and reproduce or be attractive or whatever. But you know, from the esoteric point of view, that's pretty ridiculous, because the esoteric side says that our bodies are vehicles, that we're the drivers of these vehicles. We're the consciousness in them. We need the bodies to interact with this physical world and to get from here to there, to have experiences. But the consciousness is the reason for the bodies in esoterics. And to say that the consciousness is a byproduct of the bodies is like saying that drivers are a byproduct of cars. That the whole point of the whole reason drivers evolved is so cars could all interact better with each other and have a better survival rate. That's how ridiculous it is. Another factor that's left out of science is energy. Each of us, you know, science is proposing that our energy comes from the metabolic combustion of our food. Well, yeah, I mean, that's definitely going on, and we've got energy from that source. But I realized that wasn't everything when I was about 16. And I was home, and I was feeling like bored, and I had no energy whatsoever, and I just felt like I couldn't do anything. I felt like a lot of, if you know teenagers, I couldn't do anything. And my mother came and said, I need you to vacuum the downstairs. Oh, Mom, I just don't think I can do it. I'm just not feeling very good today. Just kind of out of it. Ring, phone rings. It's my best friend. Oh yeah, that movie? You want to go to that? It's that movie you wanted to see? It's playing right now? Okay. I jump up and I realize, as a practical teenager, how do I get out of the house with Mom realizing that I have energy now? But where did that energy come from? I didn't suddenly metabolize a whole lot of extra food all of a sudden. That was emotions translated into physical energy, and that's really what we're doing all the time. We're transformers of energy. The physical body is driven by stepped down emotions. The stronger our emotional desire, the more we're able to pick up and move. That's what gets us out of bed. At some point, we get this desire to get out of bed and get something done, or fear that we're going to be in trouble if we don't. It's some emotion. And not only are emotions stepped down to physical, literally as frequency stepped down from higher frequency to lower frequency, but at the core of every emotion is an idea. That's energy stepped down from the mental plane. The same relationship from the mental to the emotional. And that's worth thinking about too, because that gets into the automatic thinking we're talking about. If you take control of the ideas that are the core of the emotions, you're taking control of your emotions. And we're all trying to get better at that in some way or another. An emotion such as that driver just cut me off in the road and we get angry, we have a conclusion in there. There's a mental thought in the middle of that that says that guy treated me wrongly. If we knew more, if we knew that person was rushing to get to the hospital, that idea would be the core of a very different emotion. Same experience, but our interpretation happens mentally, triggers the emotion. So it's really a two-step process, and if we can intercept our reactions to things at that first step, we can control the emotions that come up later. So, I guess I've dismissed science. I like science, though. I'm a scientific person, and they've really done a lot more to bring truth and facts into the picture than most institutions. So I'm not really dismissing science. It's just that, you know, a science of psychology that doesn't recognize that we're all reincarnated again and again and again is just not going to figure it out. You know, it just doesn't have the pieces to figure out human behavior. So let's look at religious approaches to the plan. I mentioned a little bit, you know, the plan that we're here in order to basically worship God, and which, according to esoterics, no divine being has any desire to be worshipped. It's a big nuisance to them anyway. If we send our energy their way, they don't need it. The problem with a religious approach to the facts of reality is that religion doesn't care about the facts. Religion is more based on emotion as well. It's based on, I mean, one of the highest expressions of religion is the mystical path. And that deep desire to connect with the divine. But to get there, you've pretty much got to put the mind aside. The mind is going to be too practical about it and say, why are you starving yourself and fasting and all that? The mystics actually put the mind aside in order to completely come into contact with the direct experience. And that's great. And we all do it in some incarnation or another. We have an incarnation of reaching for that contact. And if you're on that path, go for it. It's wonderful. But then when we get back, we discover we still have our minds to contend with. And we're human beings, are mental beings ultimately. That's our heaven world, is the mental world. We're trying to get there and get comfortable there. So even with the mystical experiences of contacting the divine, we come back and discover, well, we didn't help anybody. We helped ourselves. We made the contact with God, but now there's everybody else. So we're going to have to put our minds at work and our hearts at work and our compassion and be realistic and have common sense. That's the next step after the mystical path. And that's actually the path of esoterics, when you get oriented as a mental self. So religion, it falls into the hands of people who misuse it. They put out dogmas. They wrap a nice little bit of truth in a whole bunch of nonsense. And whatever serves the emperor of the time, it is too often distorted. So religion doesn't offer a very clear picture of the plan beyond some relatively good things like we're trying to acquire virtues. In the emotional level, you know, refining the emotional body, ennobling ourselves emotionally, that's a great function of religion. And as long as a religion's doing that, it still has a function, as long as it's helping people in that way. Whether it's got the mental facts right or not, it doesn't mean it can't help people. So I'm not entirely dismissing religion either. Sorry if it sounds like I am. Well, let's look at some, you know, we're moving beyond religion and these approaches to things, obviously, and I haven't been to all my talks. Let's look at big scale plans, like for humanity and for nations. Sometimes the plans are easier to see in retrospect. Like, look at this country. Doesn't it make sense that this country is the result of a plan that all people of every nationality and race and religion and everything somehow managed to work it out together under law instead of a monarchy? That's a big step for humanity. And for this country to pull that off, and we're doing okay at it. Not great, but we've succeeded in a large degree in that. That would seem like a plan to me that this country is based on. Here's another interesting potential plan, the Mormons. At the time that Joseph Smith in upstate New York was visited by the angelic figures and told about the golden plates and he was a very charismatic leader. It could very well be he was selected by very high level beings that I'll talk more about to lead a nice selection of genetic material out to Utah and start a culture there that was isolated from all the potential disasters that were about to hit the U.S. There was a lot of doubt at the time as to whether the east coast of the U.S. would be reduced to barbarism by the Civil War. And then the Mormons arrived in Utah in 1848. In 1849, the west coast, gold was discovered, and gold has destroyed many a civilization, the lust for it, et cetera, and it is questionable what would happen there. Between Salt Lake City and California is a vast desert of Nevada and the salt flats, and it's very nicely isolated and could have survived on its own. They're very self-sufficient, and they've always wanted to be. So that could be a plan, when you look back in retrospect, that there's a nice, self-sufficient, very hard-working bunch, and they still are. They didn't suffer nearly as much. I'm just spending a lot of time in Salt Lake City recently, part of a story I'll tell you later. But how about that? David Spangler, I was listening to him talk once, and he said that 1979, his guides came to him and said, "We're going to tell you who the next president of the United States is going to be in 1980. And they set up a big fanfare of, you know, it'd be, for him, I guess it was like a visual experience. He's very much in contact with his guys. And da-da-da, the curtains opened, and there was Ronald Reagan. And he said, "I don't want Ronald Reagan to be president." He didn't think very much of Ronald Reagan. But the devas, the beings working with him said, "Tough, he's your new president. He's going to be great." And you look back at that plan, and you think of Reagan in Berlin saying, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down that wall." And that's a beautiful moment. And you have to wonder if Reagan, the enemy of the Russians, was actually part of a plan to help the Russians. And ended up helping the Russians perhaps more than he helped us by setting them free from their communist...
Their infrastructure imploded. That's why the wall came down.
Well, that was the result of our long history of making sure that happened.
Yeah.
So, and Reagan fulfilled it. Another president might not have. Actually, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later, because right after World War II, things could have gone a lot of different ways. I mentioned those who watch over humanity, who may be behind some of these plans, and the Mormons, for instance, or helping make sure this country got founded well by sending in some nice advanced souls to help found that constitution. And if you study esoterics, it's pretty clear. Humanity is not the apex of evolution. And it's hard to imagine why anybody would think that we are when we're on the verge of destroying ourselves at all times. We're just not really reaching the potential we would hope for any intelligent beings, right? evolution of consciousness is a continuum. It goes on through all the kingdoms, mineral, vegetable, animal, human. It doesn't stop right there, human. This is a continuum that goes on and on and on and on. And I've talked about this before. The next kingdom after, the fifth, is where these beings are who have graduated from the human kingdom. They've completed what you can learn from being human. And boy, there's a lot to learn. They've graduated from the lonely suffering of humanity. That's really the worst thing about it, is how we just don't quite understand each other. And we're so separate. And we have to be, because we have to establish ourselves as individual sources of effective action. I mean, that's important. But these beings in the next kingdom, a kingdom in which everything is, it's about unity. They understand each other perfectly in this next kingdom, because each successive jump from kingdom to kingdom that we've gone through, each of us, according to Hylozoics specifically, we've gone through the mineral, the vegetable. In the vegetable kingdom, we just had subjective consciousness, the awareness of our bodies and what was happening to them. In the animal, we developed objective consciousness and the ability to move around. That was a big step. From the animal to the human was self-consciousness. That's our big difference from the animals. We can do that exercise of being aware of our consciousness. So from the human to the next kingdom, it's collective consciousness, where we can share in consciousness. That whole kingdom shares in consciousness, and we're not welcome in it when what we have to share is a bunch of human selfishness. So that's why we have to work on ourselves so much to get there. We've got to clear out, for one thing, the nonsense that we've all picked up in our childhood and education, and it's just a whole lot of that. We've got to clear that out first. And then we've got to establish a strong enough sense of who we really are so that we can not be swept away in the collective consciousness too. That's part of the loneliness and the difficulty here, but it's very important. So H.P. Blavatsky, in 1875, reintroduced humanity to those teachers from the next kingdom. And if you think about these beings in the next kingdom and what the kingdom is all about, I just mentioned it's all about unity, it's all about love and wisdom united in action. It's everybody working together in perfect cooperation. The decisions are unanimous among this leadership because they're not separated in understanding or intention. They all want to serve. It's hard for us to imagine that as humans, to be part of an organization where everybody actually is on the same page of trying to do the right thing, as willing to put their own personal interests aside to do it. But that's where we're headed. We'll get there. It's the very next kingdom. Then there are a whole bunch more. So we're almost there in a way. Why don't we see these beings? Well, they're not particularly fond of our meaty existence. They don't have to have bodies like this anymore. They don't have to hang out with a bunch of selfish people if they don't want to. It's a pretty toxic energy, actually, to hang out with the bulk of humanity. So that's why we don't see them. They're done. They've been here. They've done that. If they do interact with humanity, it's out of sheer compassion, and it's a sacrifice on their parts. But when they do, it's not through random acts of kindness. These are very intelligent beings. When you master being the human kingdom, you've mastered the mental plane as well as the emotional, and you've become an extremely mentally proficient being. They're all working together in perfect union with that mentality, and they make plans. If they act to help us, which of course, loving beings watching us suffer, that's what they do. They want to help us. So out of compassion, they make plans. Here's what one of them wrote. In 1948, looking at humanity after World War II, and it illustrates what a challenge they have helping us. And it also illustrates that, I mean, they're laying out four very different possibilities that humanity might take. And they didn't know which it would be, because there's no predestination. Even these beings who know so much more than we do, who can see all the causes, they can track back the causes that lead to everything that's going on in each of our lives here. They still don't know what we're going to choose. We have free will to choose. And if we are offered a variety of choices, typically we'll choose the worst one. Which makes this really hard to predict. I mean, that goes for all of humanity as well as individuals. So, in 1948, DK, the secretary of the planetary hierarchy, that's the name of this organization of beings from the next kingdom who was trying to help us, and it's not like a human hierarchy, the word can mislead you. When these beings are in perfect awareness of their capacity and their relationship to each other, it's very easy for them to organize themselves in a hierarchy. That's a natural order for them. They understand where they all fit in, so they call it the planetary hierarchy. The secretary, DK, they give his initials, wrote through Alice Bailey, and here's a section from her work. There were four alternatives they saw humanity taking in 1948. One is that Russia would seize power and control everything and create a totalitarian state that encompassed the whole world. And that's really not that much better than the Nazis winning. It would have been imposition of the group of relatively small group of people's will on everybody, with, however, some idealistic things behind it instead of the Nazi philosophy, which didn't have anything idealistic behind it. Another possibility was that nations would take a divisive path in an armed armistice, and that science would be prostituted to the ends of destruction, and the sure outcome of that path would be nuclear war. That was a possibility. A third option was that the world divided into blocks, you know, the Eastern Bloc and the Western Bloc, and that they would do this for economic self-support, and that was could be good, could be bad, because the blocks could also be blocks against. The Russians are particularly good at forming blocks against, you know, rather than in terms of cooperation. And the fourth option, let me read this one to you, because it's the one that actually happened, and we are involved in it to this day. A world in which the United States proves itself to be the controlling factor after wiping out Russia, which she can well do if she acts now. So it didn't quite work out that way, but it did eventually work out that we wiped out Russia. It will be predominantly a capitalistic world run by several nations but headed by the United States. A capitalistic nation is not necessarily wrong. Capital has its place, and Russia, the enemy of capitalism, is by no means free from capitalistic bias. The motives of the United States are very mixed motives. Greed of money or its equivalent, such as oil, and at the same time, sincerely good intentions for the establishment of human freedom in a democratic world, modeled, of course, on American democracy. Other motives are an appreciation of the armed fist, and boy, don't we appreciate that. And at the same time, a longing for economic sharing and for that essential kindness which is such a strong American characteristic, a mass characteristic. These mixed motives will produce eventually a very confused world, one in which it will be found that humanity has learned very little as the result of the world wars and is acquiescent to the cycle of well-intentioned money control. So there you have it. A point of view and perspective on the United States from 1948 that is as accurate today as it was then. Fascinating to see the good and the bad and why we're so confusing. We really are like a schizophrenic nation to other countries. They see all of our aid organizations out there helping, and then meanwhile we're bombing something somewhere else in their nation. You know, they can't figure out what we're up to. Well, let's talk about what the hierarchy's plan is. Their plan has been to give humanity the facts of reality. Because we paid our dues, we wandered in the dark long enough. We chose bad leadership at the end of Atlantis. We chose evil men who promised us everything and led us in a bad direction. And we chose not to have the spiritual leadership of our real teachers, these beings from the next kingdom. And we rejected them, and we have free will. We can choose our teachers. We didn't choose the right ones. And we lost the right to even have their guidance for over 12,000 years. In 1775, the hierarchy met. They looked at humanity and said, humanity's paid off most of its Atlantean karma. And there's a chance that the elite and the intellectuals and the most intelligent of humanity might be able to grasp the facts of reality now. Most of the hierarchy argued against this, saying, let's wait until the vanguard of humanity has achieved etheric vision and can see the subtle energy bodies of people, because that's our next sensory development. It's coming up just simply in our physical evolution for us to be able to see the etheric bodies. And that way would have given us the means to verify some of these facts. But there were two of the masters, Kuthumi and Master Morya, Kuthumi who had been Pythagoras, who were great lovers of humanity. And due to their desire to free us earlier than everybody else thought would be good, the rest of the hierarchy said, well, if you two are willing to take all the consequences on yourself of trying to give humanity this information, we'll let you do it. And they did. For 100 years they prepared. They inspired in Europe and other places mass movements, mass education movements, to try to teach as many people as possible to read. So that by 1875, when H.P. Blavatsky did come out with the material, there'd be the most people who could possibly at least try to understand it, have a chance. They laid groundwork in a lot of areas, a lot of people incarnated especially, to try to get the spiritual movement, spiritist, it used to be called the spiritist movement, going, to make people think about other planes, you know, with the seances and everything, but at least to get them out of such a hard-headed rational view as dominated the world in the late 1800s. Well, that's what Blavatsky had to contend with. And if you read her books, she is just hammering that hard-headed, super-rationalist, materialistic view of the 1800s. It's hard to read it now because we're not so hard-headed in it. And to have it just slammed home like that is kind of painful. But that was their plan. It has some success. This organization is a result, you know, Theosophy is certainly a result of that effort. My talk is a result of that effort. Lawrence's work, all of this is a result of the plan that people should have the facts. There was also a parallel plan that we remain ignorant, a very actively acted on plan that I've talked about in a previous talk as well. There are people in this world, very powerful individuals, whose power is based on being able to exploit humanity, being able to exploit our ignorance, our fear, our vanity, our greed, and our general selfishness, all of our lower qualities. These powerful people exploit those, and without being able to exploit those qualities, they would lose their power. And they know full well that if we start waking up, if we start achieving the next level out of civilization into culture, we're going to get into a state where we can't be controlled that way. And they'll lose their power, and they will stop at nothing to keep their power. So suppressing the information like this, ridiculing Blavatsky, making her out to be a fraud, slander is their favorite tool because it's so cheap, and there are a million gossips out there ready to spread it at a moment's notice. You know, they just say one lie and off it goes and pollutes everything. That person's reputation is destroyed. It's so easy for them to attack good people. They do. So it's not just that the hierarchy had a challenge in getting through to humanity with our hard-headedness, but it was actively opposed, and it actively, in turn, opposes those bad efforts. But once again, we need to choose who we follow. And our humanity as a whole hasn't yet chosen to be on the side of the knowledge and of the masters and the ones who really know. And as soon as we do, this world will improve tremendously. I just hope I live to see the day. So, if you know, when people talk about a plan, what is there to achieve? I mean, esoteric says that most human values are kind of skewed. We choose the survival of our bodies. We very fearfully try to protect that over our actual true nature as souls that are going to come and go from bodies. We choose to we choose comfort. We choose power over others when it's offered to us. Not a wise choice, just a way to plant seeds of bad karma. And our glamorous desires, you know, we want to live in the fancy mansion and the glamorous thing and have servants, etc. And really, the real progress, once you know about what's ahead of us, this next kingdom we're trying to reach, and even the higher worlds of the mental, that it's our destiny and our home is humanity to reach and and explore. That's the path of cooperation and altruism and self-sacrifice and love and expression, being ever more able to express love and not excluding anybody. To exclude someone is to exclude yourself from the next kingdom. This is one of the big mistakes a lot of religions make. And one of these days I'll get to talk to some Mormons about that. Since I'm out in Salt Lake City so much. The plan is to the good things I just mentioned. That's the real plan of hierarchy. Give us the information, encourage and cultivate the good qualities in humanity. We're barely expressing our creative powers. We believe things about ourselves that have tied us back. There's just so much nonsense to be cleared away. I mean, I've been reading a great book by Matthew Kelly, The Seven Levels of Intimacy. I think he's a wise person, and he says, the purpose of life is to become the best possible versions of ourselves. And that actually agrees with esoterics that says the purpose of life is the evolution of consciousness. As our consciousness evolves, we become much better versions of ourselves. So, back to trying to help humanity, the struggle that hierarchy has. I don't know how many of you have GPS units in your car. Well, mine speaks in Australian, and it will be saying, turn right, and I'll miss the turn, and it will say, recalculating, turn left. And as you can see from the variety of things that the hierarchy saw as possible for humanity at the end of World War II, they just don't know what we're going to do. So whatever plans they have are not fixed. They depend on what we choose to do. And that goes for the individual as well. When an individual just misses a great big opportunity that's handed to them, just doesn't even see it in front of them, well then, from the higher levels, it's like, oh geez, recalculating. So, and the hierarchy has to do that all the time. In fact, there were some things said in the Theosophical days. Blavatsky was tuning in on the thinking of some of the masters and said a couple things that caused some problems. She misinterpreted something, and she never claimed to be without, infallible. She never claimed to be Pope-like. She was very clear that she could make mistakes too, and according to Lawrence, she made a couple. One was her statement that no new esoteric material would be released until 1975. And that cast doubt even on the Theosophical leaders like Leadbeater and Besant, which was a problem right away. And of course, you've got Alice Bailey coming along with 19 books of fantastic information, and Lawrence E. too. There they are. Lawrence E. too. So that caused some problems. Maybe that was a part of the plan at one time, but things change. Also, there was a plan that maybe, like Atlantis was drowned, if Europe keeps getting so nasty that Europe might have to be drowned to some degree, or parts of it, or something like that, to quell the papism and the banksterism, I like that term, and the old aristocracies. But it turns out Europe took care of their own self-destruction very nicely and didn't require any help in that regard. They destroyed a lot of their old institutions very thoroughly in the world wars. In fact, leaving them a little freer to come up with new ideas than we have been. So, to finish that point, no one can say, the hierarchy can't say, they make plans, but there's no prediction that far into the future. The only thing that everybody knows for sure in the higher worlds is that we will get there, and that the whole planet will lift out of the darkness, that all of humanity is going to wake up, that every one of us will make it to the highest cosmic levels. The timing and the method is up to us, and we make such wild choices, and no one's going to predict it. Something else that Lawrence mentions I think is important, talking about government plans and Europe and everything. There is no plan among the hierarchy for one world government. In that, we would lose the uniqueness of the character of each of the nations. There is no one group of humans right now that's evolved enough to decide the proper thing for everybody. There's no government that suits every nation. We have very different personalities. Some nations are going to be fine with their god kings. And hopefully they actually get a good god king. But that's not, certainly not our style here. We'd be awfully rude to somebody that tried to be king. So that's the big scope on plans. I'll say a little bit more about that later. But the part of the plan that I know is that the hierarchy is trying to share the information now, that it's time for humanity to wake up. We have a huge, they do mention this, and if you look on the handout, there's a link to an article by Lawrence called Our Epoch. And he goes into where we're really at in a larger scale of time. And we're at the cusp of zodiacal, I don't know how you pronounce it, epoch, from Piscean to Aquarian. And we've got something called the seventh ray coming in, seventh department, Lawrence calls it. It's a kind of energy that's one of the notes of the this octave of all energies. All frequencies are divided into an octave, right? And then it repeats. So they have notes with special characteristics, the first note, the power note, you know, but it's the seventh that's coming in. It has a lot to do with organization, with magic, with law. That combined with the Aquarian energy gives us an opportunity such as we will not have again in a long time. So who knows how many thousands of years. So there's a great hope that we'll take full advantage of that. Humanity can make big steps forward. I know that's part of the possibilities. What the plan is to get us there, I'm afraid I don't know any masters. They don't tell me. But I can tell you a little bit more about myself, because I think sharing the personal side of plans too is important. My first marriage was a karmic marriage. And here's an interesting thing that only Lawrence has talked about in anything I've read, that before you're born, Goades, which is your guardian angel, the representatives of the karmic departments, you know, of reaping, your own sponsor, master, whoever is involved in your progress, they get together and really work out what's the purpose of this incarnation. Each incarnation does have a purpose. That's for each of us to work out. It can be quite different. Some incarnations, the purpose is reaping, is to come in and suffer. And deep down, we know that's true, though. And that's why we judge people harshly sometimes when we shouldn't. Some people come in just to pay off a lot of debts at once. And the tougher they are, the more they pay off in one lifetime. They know full well, and they signed up for that before they come in. They pick those parents that are so bad, and they come in to really straighten a lot of things out. Thank goodness that this incarnation is not one of those for me. Well, maybe my first marriage, actually, if I think about it. But well, these beings that get together and prepare things for your life, they create something called a karmic elemental. And an elemental is basically a strongly held together, it's a kind of a being of its own that exists just for a purpose. It's like a thought form that has strictly the purpose of fulfilling some intention. And these beings put a tremendous amount of energy into that, and that's attached to you. And as you go through life, this karmic elemental can make sure that some events happen, the ones that you chose. You know, before we were born, we chose these things. It's not like it's necessarily forcing it on us. It's just we don't know it when it happens. And that karmic elemental can just make sure that you say, why don't we get married after you've known somebody for 10 days? And affect the same person the same way, the other person the same way, and you find yourself completing a karmic destiny. Well, destiny is a kind of a different topic. My first wife and I, through horrible circumstances thousands of years ago in a previous life that I got a chance to see, did not successfully raise the child we had. It was awful. And I don't want to go into just because this is the thing. I wouldn't be too fascinated about past lives, really. Because if you start getting into it, you'll discover a lot of awful things that you may have done or may have been done to you, neither of which you really want to remember and associate with yourself, or you're just not, in this lifetime, it interferes with you really being a new person. But I got to see that because I insisted. I had to find out what this is all about, why I was going through this divorce, and it didn't make a whole lot of sense to me, and I got to see. And then it made a lot of sense, and I had to accept it. This lifetime we raised a child together, and we completed that. And the life that I owed her from that previous lifetime, Well, you can pay off a whole lifetime in maybe 10 years this time around, because things are much more concentrated now. You know, you live three lifetimes. Any one of us here could be living the equivalent of three lifetimes compared to what we were doing 100, 200 years ago. Time is sped up in a way. You know, we might have three careers and three spouses. And well, such as I am going to have, it looks like. My second marriage is all about finding somebody I was really comfortable with, and we were just old friends from another incarnation. It was a wonderful thing, but as Matthew Kelly says, when a relationship stops growing, it's dying. And a relationship that's really about being comfortable, even if it's healing from really bad things, eventually is not satisfying. We're here to accomplish more than just be comfortable. The interesting thing happened to me a year ago yesterday. I was riding the ferry home from Port Townsend, the Kingston Ferry. The Kingston Ferry out of Edmonds. And I was walking on the top deck, and the moon was reflecting in the water. It was just me up there. Nobody goes up there when it's cold, so I like it. I'm up there by myself. And I was thinking about the first girl I ever kissed. I took her to the junior prom. We were 14. And had been in love with her ever since then. And deep in my heart, she was always the one that I wanted. I knew that. But she wasn't available and didn't even show that much interest in me. So the thing is, over all those years, I didn't see her for 20 years after high school. I saw her at our 20-year reunion and discovered that my 20 years of trying to forget about her had all been wasted. She was just immediately back in my consciousness, just like before. But she had little kids and she was married, and I knew I had to forget all about it all over again. Well, I called her after that every few years, but that's the only contact I had with her, except in my dreams. She kept coming to my dreams. She would come and remind me. It was always such a great dream. She would remind me what love really was in those dreams. And I was so happy to be with her and be in that space of, oh yeah, this is what I thought love ought to be like, and it is, and here with you it is in this dream. And as I walked on that ferry on November 3rd, 2011, I thought about her. Hadn't talked to her in 3 years. I was thinking, what a shame. I wish I had gotten to know her better. I wish she had gotten to know me. She doesn't even know me. My phone chimed, and it was her. Would you like to join my LinkedIn network? We started sending emails, and a week later I talked to her, and when I talked to her on the phone, she said, I just filed my divorce papers today after a 26-year marriage. Got off the phone and discovered my employer just gave me a $5,000 bonus, which gave me enough money to fly out there for Thanksgiving, out to Salt Lake City to see her. Things just lined up really well, and we were obviously supposed to be together. But this is an interesting thing. That's more of a destiny thing. I had to survive long enough and still be somebody who had enough pieces left, you know, and a heart that wasn't too badly torn up by all the prior things, in order to be with her. And I somehow managed to survive enough to have that relationship, and I'm so happy with it now. She couldn't know, however. She couldn't even have the dreams or remember them, because she was in this marriage that had just died. And she spent years dealing with guilt that she would want to leave it, that she didn't love this person. She wanted to love him. She tried to love him. She did everything. She read the books, everything, went to the counselors. Finally, she realized that each of us is responsible for our own happiness. No one is more responsible than us. No one is going to make us happy. We are the ones that make ourselves happy or unhappy. And she decided that she had, in order not to die in this relationship, she had to leave it. And she did. And the moment she did and filed those papers, then she could know about me, who had been there all along waiting for her. Otherwise, she would have been leaving that marriage for me, and she couldn't have done that. That wouldn't have worked in her mind as a legitimate reason to end a marriage. Over the few months before she met me, she liked to go to talk to psychics. And the psychics, three different psychics, told her different things. One said, oh, you've got a high school boyfriend. It's going to reappear in November. And she said, no, that's impossible, because I didn't actually graduate with her I wasn't there the last 2 years of high school with her, and she thought of all the guys she graduated with, nope, not going to happen. She just completely dismissed that. Then another guy said, what are you doing with this Swedish guy? You need this Irish guy that, I see him in your field, he's perfect for you. I think he was seeing me, he likes to walk. If you get together with him, you guys are going to walk everywhere, and that's what we do. And then there was a third person too that said something to her about something that predicted me. I don't remember exactly what that was. But it made her quite ready, at least, to meet me. So that's a wonderful thing. I had no idea that was ahead of me. You know, when you think you know the plan, you probably don't really. There's some, and we tend to judge on, oh, well, I don't know how good it could be. This was better than I thought it could possibly be, to be with the person I always wanted to be with and just the person of my dreams and be so happy. Don't be surprised, you know, by really good things coming. It can happen. Valerie.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are you married?
Well, I'm not even actually fully divorced yet is the problem. So as soon as that's done, which should be like sometime in December.
No, I was reading your Zukav before I came here this morning, Seed of the Soul. And he was saying that the archetypical marriage is leaving us because it doesn't work anymore. And he says that if partners don't grow spiritually, they will leave each other. Mm-hmm.
And it's for the best. And it's for the best for kids, too. Rather than having two people miserable with each other trying to make a family, you're better off having two happy people.
But the archetypical marriage now has got to be more of a spiritual marriage and not a marriage for survival. In other words, she stays home, takes care of the kids, and he provides
right.
the shelter. So we're beyond that now. So it's changing rapidly. And I thought, well, your story is an interesting example of that.
Well, we are very much looking forward to trying to be an example of a really great marriage. And as soon as I'm divorced, I'll be proposing. But first things first. Well, it's not official until I can actually do it. So, I mentioned Agoides, our guardian angel. That's a really key, and in the handout, make sure to get a handout that's by the door. There's a link there that you can type in and get to an article by Henry Lawrence on Agoides. I gave a whole talk on the soul and a lot about Agoides already. But this is a being of a much higher level who's joined with us in a very interesting way ever since our jump from the animal to the human kingdom many, many millions of years ago. Anybody in this room has got 100,000 incarnations behind him at least. And it's millions of years separate us from being animals. At that point, we acquired a new body. It's made of the higher mental, the material of the higher mental planes, the soul body, it's called. The soul attached to us as individuals. Animals have group souls. They share a common body on that level. But we each are, humans are the most individual of all beings, you know, and so isolated. The Agoides actually provides the causal body, it's called. The causal body is like, it's a version of ourselves in a higher, subtler world that holds all of our experiences. Everything from past incarnations, abilities, qualities. We can't handle it all. When we come into incarnation, we get just a small selection of all the things that we are and have been. We get some abilities. Like this lifetime, I didn't get the ability to visualize it. I don't have a visual sense. Otherwise, I probably would have been an artist, and that would have been my focus. And instead, I get to focus on music and poetry and dancing and other things this lifetime. And it's a good thing when you don't have all of your ingredients in one lifetime. But each incarnation, we contribute to our causal selves' full set of qualities. And when we've acquired enough of various qualities and a steadfast enough ability to concentrate and know ourselves to be the conscious beings we are, it becomes possible to finally wake in that body. And then you become a causal self, such as Blavatsky was, and Leadbeater and Besant, and many new abilities open up. And it's one of the fantastic promises of esoterics is that we're getting close to being able to wake up as that being. And in death is no more for such a being. It's continuity of consciousness from there on out for the remaining, who knows how many billions of years ahead of us we have. because you don't suffer from the unconsciousness of losing bodies. We identify with our bodies now, physical, emotional, mental. The causal is above all those things, and we know ourselves to be that. All the rest of the bodies can come and go, but we still know who we are. That's ahead of us. A goetes is our stand-in at that level, has provided that body, acts in that body in a way. Whether we identify with that body as ourselves or as with it as a separate being, as a goetes that we're communicating with, is up our own business. It really is both us and another being. It's this beautiful soul of us that is guiding and helping us, and it's the solution for the big nasty question: how is it that I'm here being a clunky human and I'm a divine being at the same time? You know, that always puzzled me. If I'm so divine on some level, as I was told by so many of the, you know, not the old religious stuff, the New Age things are telling you, you're really a divine, beautiful soul with all kinds of powers and knowledge. Well, then what am I doing here being so stupid? And the fact is that we are this person here struggling in this world. And at the same time, it's only a part of us that's here, of our qualities. It's our consciousness, our point of self is here, but on the higher level there is this beautiful being for us to communicate with, our souls. It's just our sponsor in a way. It's Lawrence introduces this, and none of the others have dared to, because it's so hard to explain, and it can be confusing. But what that means is that you have a very intelligent, super powerful being that is not only interested in you, it's partly is you, that is your sponsor and helping you at all times, giving you opportunity after opportunity, magnetizing you to the people that you need to meet, making sure that the weave of karma and destiny works out for you. I mean, everything that happens to us is a result of our actions. We've planted the seeds of everything good or bad that we harvest. That's the law of reaping, and it holds true down to the tiniest little thing. But we don't weave it all together into a lifetime or an incarnation and choosing parents and all that. That takes the higher beings that help us. That's the goetes stepping in, the guardian angel, and making something that we can learn from that's not too much for us, you know, that works off a certain amount of karma and acquires that certain amount of new qualities and gives us a couple opportunities in case we can really go for it in some incarnation. That's an encouraging thing, to know that this being that's all about love is all about you. And people who pray and are contacting beings in their praying are reaching that being. This is the contact with divinity that we each have, that we first reach. And we might think of it as reaching God even, or a divine being, but we're really reaching a goetes and our higher self. Our ultimate self, Lawrence, he points out, is the finest indivisible point of matter, motion, and consciousness that he calls the monad, which is a different meaning of the word than in theosophy. He says that's what we are. Everything else is body. Even the soul, even the higher beings' bodies than that we'll eventually acquire, that the great divine beings require entire planets for their bodies of incarnation, they are, at essence, one monad, one point of matter and of consciousness. And that's what we are too. And that actually, after thinking about it a lot, that worked for me with common sense too, because if we're not that one thing, then what are we, a collection of things? Are we a hodgepodge? Where's the boundary? What's us and what's not us? You know? And that monad is what's climbing through the kingdoms. That's what's inhabiting us right now. That's where our attention comes from. If we do our self-consciousness exercise, that's ultimately where the attention comes from. Our ultimate self is the monad, the indivisible, indestructible, absolutely immortal monad. That's another encouraging thing. Nothing is going to hurt us. Oh, thank you. Only our bodies can be injured. And our monad's destiny is to wake up completely and know itself to be one with the one consciousness of everything. It's worth a whole talk, and I actually have given big chunks of talks about it before, so I can't spend too much time on it now. Well, let's look at individual lives. They're also different, you know. If we look at a plan, there's certainly no one plan fits all. There's some people that come in and they're the rebels and they don't care what their soul thinks. They don't care what anybody thinks. They're going to do exactly what they want to do. They're not going with the flow. They're not going with any plan. They make the plan. It's their plan. They're going to execute it. That's a tough way to learn, but you do learn that way and you get really strong because you meet nothing but resistance. However, getting really strong is a good thing. And when you get to the next kingdom, when you finally do realize that it's all about unity and that your own plan is just not going to make it anywhere, you're going to have to work with everybody else, and you start to realize, oh, I can be part of, you know, I can share and be part of a much, that's how you become much greater, is joining in and being part of a much greater collective consciousness. Well, those beings are special troubleshooters for humanities that are having difficulty. They say, this is what Lawrence says, is those beings that have struggled and fought and insisted on their own way and took an extra million years because they didn't want to do it according to anybody else's plan but their own. They come out so tough and determined that they become experts in helping struggling humanities. So certainly judging people is one of the humanity's biggest mistakes. We tend to want to think of somebody having a misspent life. It's a terrible thought. You know, Lawrence, he points to phrases like a fallen woman. God, what a horrible idea. That a woman's fallen and can't get up. So, how do we know what Agoides has come up with for a plan to help us? Because Lawrence, he says, the fastest progress you can make, if that's what you want to do, is progress quickly. The very fastest way to go is to be working in harmony with the plan that Agoides has got. And how do we know that Agoides, we're in harmony with that plan? Well, for one thing, you can have contact with Agoides, and sometimes it's just once in a lifetime. But if you haven't ever had that, if you've never had that contact with the divine in yourself, you can ask for it. I highly recommend it. See what happens. Another thing you can look at is your own life, and you can pretty much assume that where you're at and who you're with and what you're doing is exactly where you're supposed to be to have the lessons that you need. And even if it's because it's your own choices and it wasn't the Agoides' plan, you're learning something about your own choices that's very important. Running away, well, you end up just delaying things. And suicide, the ultimate running away, is a horrible way to delay things. Everything that you never dealt with, you have to come back and, well, you stay in the midst of it in between lives for a great long time. It's supposedly quite horrible, and probably everybody does it, one incarnation at least. So, if the plan is to lift humanity from suffering, fear, and doubt, out of victimhood, this is a big human thing, to be victims, you know, to just not get it that we're responsible for our own lives and want to blame everything and everybody else. If that plan is for us to be raised to a state of culture, Lawrence, he calls culture the next level, barbarian, civilizational, cultural, humanity, true humanity, and then ideality, the five stages. And humanity is currently at the civilizational level. We've basically just kind of made it out of the barbaric level, and we're willing to obey the traffic lights now. You know, at the civilizational level, people kind of realize, well, if you cooperate a little bit, it works out better. But we're nowhere near a cultural level where we appreciate each other on a higher emotional level. The cultural level is we're operating at the higher attractive emotional level, the higher octaves of the emotional world of admiration and affection and appreciation and gratitude. The lower level, of course, we're really familiar with that level of emotionality. We run into it all the time, of anger and jealousy and, you know, there's plenty of that. So when humanity makes that shift, not only do we all move to a much happier place, but we strip all the power away from the evil, organized evil people who are trying to control humanity. They would like to keep us in a medieval state. That's kind of their idea, a feudal state where the local lord can do whatever the hell he wants.
Do you have a list of those people?
I won't mention what political party I think they predominate in. Maybe I should. Tuesday is right around the corner. I think you probably can guess. So, you know, as I've gone through this talk, I've hit along a lot of the main themes that I've hit in other talks. This is my seventh talk, and I'm going to make a book out of each talk. Each talk is going to be a chapter in a book. That's going to be a big achievement for me to get that done. I'm not scheduling any more talks here right now because I'm living in Salt Lake City and here at the same time, and I don't know where I'm going to wind up with Valerie. We don't know what our destiny is to be together, but among the things I mentioned and reiterated today, we are eternal beings. We take form again and again and again and again to work things out in form, and we get better and better forms, fortunately. There are plans for on a big level, on a planetary level, on a national level, on a religious, racial group level, and certainly individual plans. We can relax a little bit and not think that we have to make every plan. I mentioned the higher worlds, how they're free from the problems. They're free from suffering. Suffering's a human level thing, an animal and human particularly. I'm not sure how much plants suffer, but we certainly know how to suffer here. In fact, these bodies that we have were designed for it. Most humanities on other planets only get as dense as the etheric, which is the subtler than our physical, it's the energy body of our physical bodies. Earth is a place where humanity has come all the way down into these organismic bodies for a couple of reasons, and that is because it gives you a really good opportunity to suffer and develop compassion. And, well, that's the bulk of it, really. The monads that have come to Earth I'm sorry to categorize us all this way, but there's a general, and Lawrence says this, that Earth is where the monads of repellent tendency go to learn about compassion and to overcome that repellent tendency and require attractive tendency. And having bodies such as ours and difficulties such as we have and evil to combat such as we have really highlights things for us, puts it all in contrast. And the very fact of evil existing in this world makes it possible for us to go through it faster. Having that resistance and having that contrast, so the light, the light and the dark, I mean, like World War II, evil stood up and announced itself. It wasn't like we had to go find it. We could see what was good and bad. We got to really choose. Right now, it's more subtle, and we have to look for choosing within ourselves for it, because we've all got our little share in it. But without this capacity to suffer, we wouldn't develop compassion. Without evil to fight, we wouldn't develop the strength of righteousness, you know? I hate to use the words overused by religious things, but righteousness has really got a great idea behind it. So these higher worlds, there's so many of them. Lawrence numbers the worlds from the top down. And the whole physical plane is world 49. Then the emotional is 48. The mental is 47. And that's really divided into two. The higher mental, which is absolutely a heaven world for us that we're striving for, where the causal body is and where our higher mental consciousness is anchored. Everything higher than that is we're worlds of unity. It's only the worlds below and the world we're in right now that we struggle with the differences between each other and not understanding. We struggle in ignorance and, you know, as the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus Christ had, Jesus the Christ had a great quote, two sturdy asses bind the will of man, fear and doubt. Thought that was a good one. So we're going to overcome all these limitations and we're getting there. We've got Goetheus to help us. It's a little bit tougher when we're kind of ahead of the bulk of humanity struggling with this. The bulk of humanity will all just get carried along with each other toward it, but I'm not waiting for them. something else I've hit on in a number of different ways. Great laws are at work here that all beings are subject to. And working within the laws is really the technique of the esoterician, of the master. The masters, the beings of the higher kingdom, work in perfect harmony with the laws. They don't plant the seeds of destruction by accident, or like humans do all the time. We act in such ignorance of the laws. I mean, it amazes me that such powerful beings can plunder the weak in our country. You know, Enron shutting off the power in California to hold it hostage to its need to make some more money. These are very intelligent. They call themselves the smartest people in the room. That was their nickname for themselves, the Enron guys. They're plenty smart, but they didn't know that every action that you take has a reaction. They don't know that. That's not very smart. Certainly the law of reaping, this is the big success of theosophy, I think, is to reintroduce that in the West. People have an idea about karma now. And it's not necessarily the Indian idea of karma, which can be the ideas there have been in mass consciousness there for so long, they've gotten messed up a little bit. Like the idea in reincarnation that you could reincarnate as an animal or a plant, that's completely wrong. Once you've made the jump to human, you're just made of what makes a human. You can't be unmade. You never go back. You don't go back to being an animal. And karma too, like the inevitable karma, you can't fight it, you just better submit, you're just gonna get rolled over by karma. Well, no, your actions have a lot to do with how you realize, how you experience karma. You can offset it with good actions. You can change a very strong destiny to suffer by getting the idea of compassion and acting compassionately and seeing that other people are just as important as you are. And that's a big realization, that the fact that one of you is happy is just as important as the fact that I'm happy. That's gotta be true. It can't be more important that I'm happy than the rest of you. That can't be true. Yet we act that way. So rebirth, certainly talked about that. Self-realization, nobody can wake us up really. Nobody can progress us. Everything we have, and I'm not just talking about our knowledge and our skills, our ability to be in this body and digest food, we acquired through our own efforts as a paramecium or something long ago. We've made it through all these kingdoms. Our ability to speak and see and everything was the result of a great amount of effort on our part. We've been working on it for millions of years. Nothing is free, actually. Everything we have, we work to have. And everything we're going to have, well, let's get busy, let's desire it, let's create it. Let's ask what is required from us to have this thing that we want, to be in beautiful, loving unity with the divine, for instance. Well, what's required of us? There's work and all these things, but there are also all kinds of beings that want to help us. Law of freedom I talked about, very important. There are no beings above us that give commandments or orders whatsoever. They don't want to be worshipped. The God of the Old Testament, we got to really let that guy go. Because he was a jealous, angry version, a human, you know, a projection of our worst qualities onto God. And that's a pretty bad thing to do, project our worst qualities onto God. So, what if all the things I'm talking about were true? What would that mean? I'd say it's a good reason to find out a little bit more. And if you want to read more, on the back table there is a chapter of Lawrence's that I really have enjoyed, where he praises American philosophers and says that the American philosophers looked at religion and philosophy and said, we want something better than all this. And they came up with a philosophy of positive thinking versus negative thinking. It's a pretty easy thing. You know, positive is what supports growth, what encourages unity, what frees instead of limits. And negative is what does the opposite. It reduces our possibilities of learning and growing and enjoying life and loving. You can really sort things out pretty well that way. And he says, basically, we make ourselves happy, we make ourselves miserable, it's all up to us. He says how we do it through choosing what we think about, how we indulge in negative thinking, and that's a really bad idea, when really it's our creative potential is barely touched. We could be creating much better lives for ourselves if we took a little time to imagine it. So I really encourage you to read that. You know, if everything I'm saying makes a lot of sense, well, you've probably heard it before. You know, you've heard it in other lifetimes. You've heard it in Theosophy here. If it doesn't make sense, well, I think it's still the most rational thing I've found, and I think if you investigate it further, you'll find out that nothing is going to prove it wrong, because it's different than a speculation or a religious, you know, pseudo view of things. It's just a description of what is. That's really what the esoteric information is all about. It's not trying to say, here's a big mental construction I've given you. It's just saying, there's only one reality. Everything is what it is. This is a description. And that's pretty hard to contradict. If you're describing what is, no one's going to be able to contradict it. You know, we're told in the esoteric books that the real satisfaction, the ultimate joy in life that we're all headed for, is when we really get that breakthrough and we realize how important everybody else is, and we start living to serve the plan and the love and the possibilities of brotherhood and the possibilities of improving the world. And in fact, it says that we're not going to make it to the next kingdom until we have had that realization. You're not welcomed into the collective consciousness of the next kingdom until you understand that your needs are not more important than anyone else's. And you've cleaned up enough of your stuff, too. So this is a big lifetime for most people, I think, of cleaning stuff up, because we get a lot more light now to be able to see, well, actually, I don't want to be like that anymore, and clean out those old patterns and habits and bad beliefs. And if you clean that up enough, and you've integrated your personality some, so your mind, your emotions, your physical nature work together to some degree so that you can make a plan and execute it, well, then you can participate in the larger plan. Somebody who's still cluttered up with the wrong ideas actually can do a lot more harm than good trying to be helpful. And some of the worst things have been done in the name of being helpful. Like I mentioned here, the United States sometimes tries to be helpful, but its mixed motives and its lack of clarity about what it's trying to do does more harm than good quite often. We've got Christian missionaries going down and destroying Mayan cultures, you know, things like that, even today. But we all have the opportunities that are presented just by knowing a little more than other people. I mean, I find this so encouraging to be able to, I think I ought to be able to have a chance to reacquaint myself with this knowledge in a new incarnation. And that's partly because I'm sharing it. And that's not really why I'm sharing it, but it's a good byproduct I'm very much hoping for, because I don't want to go through another life when I don't know these things. This is really good, helpful for me to live, to know that there is a plan, it's about love, we're almost there, we're immortal in essence, we're improving, we're not born in sin or whatever like that, we're just limited by our ignorance and our inability, and those things are going away. So that message is not widely enough known. People suffer so much for not knowing that. So if you want to know more about it, read the Lawrencey books. They're just so, Lawrencey is just, I think, the clearest possible approach to all these things. And he's Western. He's not Eastern, which Eastern approaches tend to try to get you to use your intuition. And yeah, that's great, but Lawrencey just tells you. You don't have to try to use your intuition. He just tells you. I like that. And if you actually do get involved in trying to help, and that's, no one's going to tell you to. You're not going to have a master come along and say, oh, we've been waiting for you to be ready. Here's a big mission for you. That doesn't happen. We're surrounded by need that we really can see around us, the people that are in the dark, and there are plenty of opportunities to help. And the minute we start trying to help, we get help from other worlds and energy forms and ideas and magnetization with other people, with resources. It comes to us. And one of the nice rewards of trying to help is that the higher beings can look at you and say, you know what? This person's actually doing something good. And they give you a glimpse. Not like, here, I'm giving you a glimpse. You just have it. You get a wider picture of the plan that includes the part you're working on. And you get to see how this thing that you're doing fits into a bigger plan. And that can be that's a very reassuring thing too. You know, any kind of contact with the higher thinking like that is just exciting as can be. It's one thing to want to help, it's another thing to really have the desire to, and it's important that the heart is just as involved in the mind. The mind can't do it by itself. You'll be ready when your heart is ready too. There is one thing the hierarchy has said we can do, that anybody can do. In the books, they gave an invocation that people can use. And in my Rainbow Bridge meditation groups, and whenever I have a get-together of people who can handle it, and I hope you can, we do this invocation together. An invocation is drawing in energy. It's asking for the energy to flow from the higher worlds. And we've been given this formula that will, we're told, cause tremendous effects in the world. And it's called the Great Invocation, interestingly enough. It's on the back page of the handout, if you've got it. Well, I notice some of you don't have the handout. But if you want to say it along with me, fine. If not, I'm just going to say it. And this is going to be my conclusion to the talk.
Stan, can you answer a question?
Yeah.
It's about the seventh ray, and you gave a cliff notes of organization and order. And I'm wondering, does it help to pull it in? Are we meant to pull in the seventh ray, or is the seventh ray already there? We just have to awaken to it, and by acknowledging it with these cliff notes that you gave of order and organization,
magic.
Are we aligning ourselves to it?
Let me answer that. That's a great question. Let me answer that right after we do the invocation.
Thank you.
Right. I think that's true too. Once you get a good view, they say the disciples, meaning those who've been accepted as students of the masters, they can't stay off the path for long. So I'm just going to read this and say this together, and you may not have thought about the meaning of it very much, but it's fairly clear. And please say it with me if you'd like. From the point of light within the mind of God, let light stream forth into the minds of men. Let light descend on earth. From the point of love within the heart of God, let love stream forth into the hearts of men. May Christ return to earth. From the center where the will of God is known, let purpose guide the little wills of men, the purpose which the masters know and serve. From the center which we call the race of men, let the plan of love and light work out, and may it seal the door where evil dwells. Let light and love and power restore the plan on earth. Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, it's 5:30 and the talk is officially over. But if you got questions, I'm going to answer them. But let me answer hers first and get back to you. Because she was first. Seventh ray of ceremonial order, they call it.
Ceremonial.
And ceremonial magic. And when you play the seventh note in music, you're leading into the power note. That's how you set a key. You know, you might play that and then play the power note, the first note, right after that. So it kind of sets the stage for energy to flow. It's the end of the octave, so it's bridging you to the next octave. So that's maybe one reason they say it's so powerful, the seventh ray, is that it's getting ready to bridge us into a lot more energy coming through. So how would you work with it, you're asking?
Or is it already present and there's nothing for us to do? Or are we actually meant to keep our attention there and look for those ceremonial ritual moments?
It's here, one form in which it's here is that souls on that ray incarnate in a greater, much greater frequency as the ray comes in. So you meet individuals who have that energy in particular. And the early industrial titans of the 1800s actually were some of the early seventh ray people because they were masters of manifesting and organization. And such people had not been seen before. And of course they took over industry.